In the following video, you'll learn the basics of an oral cancer screening examination. The purpose of this exam is to detect cancer early, or better yet, before it happens. If you can catch cancer early, the patient has a much greater chance of a cure and of living a normal life. Every patient at any age can develop oral cancer, but the highest risk patient is generally older and male. Ask whether the patient is a smoker or ex-smoker. Other risk factors include alcohol, betel nut products, poor diet, and previous head and neck cancer. Human papillomavirus may also be a risk, especially for tonsil cancer. Ask the patient about unusual changes in their mouth and listen for changes in their voice. Start by examining the head, neck, and face for changes in color, contour, consistency, and function. First look, then palpate. Explain what you're doing and why. You may see irregular pigmentation and premature wrinkling. This can signal sun damage and the risk of skin cancers. You can use the American Cancer Society's ABCDE rule to assess for melanoma risk in pigmented lesions. Look for asymmetry, border irregularity, color variation, diameter larger than 6 millimeters, and evolution over time. Inspect and palpate the ears, including the pinna, lobe, auricle, and visible portions of the external auditory canal. The sclera of the eye should be white. Yellow may indicate jaundice and liver disease. Hematomas might indicate a blood disorder. The eyes should be able to follow your finger. There should be no enlargement of the lacrimal glands, no swelling, and no drainage. Assess function of the facial muscles and the cranial nerves. If you see any deficit, figure out which nerve is affected. Palpate firmly enough to feel the subepithelial structures, but not hard enough to hurt your patient. Alternating between observation and palpation allows you to understand the structure's shape and size. It also helps you avoid surprising the patient and yourself by suddenly palpating a painful structure, and it keeps you from altering a lesion by palpation before you get a chance to see it. Palpate the nose and peek up the anterior portion of the nares for abnormalities. Examine the neck lymph nodes next. Palpate the spinal accessory nodes, moving the tissues across the trapezius muscle to aid detection. If a lymph node is palpable, note its size and whether it's hard or soft, painless or painful, freely movable or fixed. It should move freely. Bimanually palpate the neck, comparing right and left sides for asymmetry, looking for enlarged painless lymph nodes and other abnormal masses. If an abnormal finding is present for more than 2 weeks, consider appropriate referral. The patient should relax her head against the headrest, and if she gently droops her head forward, it might help you palpate more easily. Palpate the jugular chains using deeply placed fingers on either side of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, all the way from its origin at the clavicle to its insertion at the mastoid process, including the retroauricular nodes behind the ear. Include the anterior scalene and supraclavicular nodes above the clavicles and the Delphian nodes near the inferior midline of the neck. Examine the front of the neck next. The butterfly-shaped thyroid gland should have no nodules or masses. Palpate the larynx for enlargement or immobility. Listen for hoarseness. Watch the patient swallow. Structures should move freely up and down. An enlarged carotid bifurcation feels different from a lymph node. It has a pronounced pulse. Palpate the submandibular and sublingual nodes extraorally between the fingers and the lingual aspect of the mandible, and later as part of the intraoral examination. View and feel the parotid gland, including its tail below the angle of the mandible, along with the preauricular lymph nodes. Make sure you compare right and left sides. Evaluate the lips, both open and closed, taking a close look at the vermilion border, commissures, and mucosa. The patient should remove her lipstick before this portion of the examination. The color of the lip vermilion should be uniform and pink. The junction between the vermilion and skin should be crisp. There should be no cracking at the commissures, which might indicate a candida or bacterial infection, also associated with anemia and drooping at the corners of the mouth. Palpate the lips between the thumb and fingers. It's normal to feel minor salivary glands, but they should be all approximately the same in size. You often see dysplastic changes on the lips of sun-exposed adults, such as this 90-year-old, in the form of actinic chylitis. The vermilion border becomes blurred and ill-defined with rough, scaly, white and red zones. Persistent ulceration or induration may signal the onset of squamous cell carcinoma. Counsel these patients to avoid the sun, use sunblocks, and have regular skin examinations. Ask the patient to remove all appliances and prostheses before continuing the examination into the oral cavity. View the entire buccal mucosa by retracting the tissues. Bilateral linea alba, as seen in this case, are normal, as is the prominent Stenson's parotid duct. Compare the results of your inspection and palpation between right and left. You should feel some small, uniform salivary glands. The most common submucosal masses are salivary gland tumors, enlarged lymph nodes, or lipomas. Smooth surface exophytic masses are usually focal fibrous hyperplasia. If the buccal mucosa is diffusely white, stretch the cheek. If it disappears, it's probably leukoedema. Lacy white lines, if multifocal and bilateral, may be lichenoid drug reaction, contact allergy, or occasionally lichen planus. A malignancy in this region is usually indurated and red. When in doubt, check it out. Next, take a close look at the color, contour, consistency, and function of the alveolar processes and gingiva. As you look at the midline of this patient, you'll see a maxillary frenum tag, which is not pathology, but a developmental condition, stable once formed. You may see occasionally a discrete gingival mass, often called an epulis. This umbrella term includes gingival fibroma, pyogenic granuloma, peripheral giant cell granuloma, peripheral ossifying fibroma, and other conditions. Bony contour changes may also be present. One sign of oral cancer that's sometimes overlooked is a tooth with bone loss out of proportion to the rest of the arch, with no definite etiology such as a cracked root. Be very suspicious of such a situation. Another is a poorly healing extraction site. Bony tori are usually stable and bilateral. Odontogenic cysts and tumors can cause unilateral alveolar expansion. It's easier to inspect the edentulous ridges, as you can see in this elderly patient. If there's a lot of ridge resorption, the mental nerve may be located close to the alveolar crest and may develop a painful nodule called a traumatic neuroma. The denture patient may be prone to other lesions, such as denture stomatitis, epulis fissuratum, a fissured mass at the denture's edge, palatal papillomatosis, multiple nodules on the palate, and candidiasis, which can be pseudomembranous, where the white wipes off, atrophic, where the tissues are fire engine red, or hyperplastic, where the epithelium is white, rough, and the white doesn't rub off. Identify and try to explain any submucosal swellings. The hard palate's the most common intraoral site for minor salivary gland tumors, which could be benign or malignant, and is also a site where lymphoma can occur. Smokers may have nicotinic stomatitis, a white wrinkled palate with red dots, but this can also occasionally be seen in patients who drink very hot beverages. Torus palatinus is located on the midline and is stable once formed, and incise of canal cyst is located in the anterior midline and might leak a salty fluid. A good view of the soft palate, uvula, and tonsillar pillars is worth the effort, as tumors here often go undetected. Try to view this area when the patient says, "Ah." You may need a tongue depressor or a mirror. A last resort is to watch the area closely as the patient gags. In this patient, you see multiple small red benign lymphoid nodules, which should be transient. Palpate as much as you can, certainly the soft palate and the uvula. If needed, palpate the tonsil from the side. Squamous cell carcinoma and lymphoma are the most common malignancies of this area. Unexplained earache can be associated with pharyngeal cancers. Palpate the base of the tongue behind the circumvallate papilla using a sweep of the finger. This area is hard to see without special equipment. Pull the tongue forward gently, getting a firm grip with gauze, in order to view the entire dorsal tongue. Wipe away any debris. Closely inspect the lateral and ventral tongue along its entire length. This is where half of all oral cancers arise. In this patient, the red nodules bilaterally on the posterior lateral tongue are foliate papilla, corresponding with the nodules seen in the pharynx. They're bilateral, further assurance that they're benign. Reactive lymphoid tissue such as this should become less apparent once the stimulus, like an infection, resolves. Make sure to complete this step by thoroughly palpating the tongue. Careful attention to this very important area of the mouth could make a significant impact on early detection of oral cancer. Finally, the floor of the mouth needs to be inspected and palpated. About a third of intraoral cancers occur here. Ask the patient to raise her tongue to the floor of her mouth so you can see well. The floor of the mouth is an unusual site for trauma or infection, so if you see any red or white lesion, think carefully about the need for biopsy, especially if it's indurated. Use two hands to palpate this area, one inside the mouth and one below the chin. Also assess the sublingual and submandibular glands at the same time. Oral cancer strikes over 35,000 Americans a year and kills about 8,000. Dentistry's best current hope for improving this sad statistic rests in your hands and eyes. Do a thorough oral cancer screening exam on every patient every year, looking for changes in color, contour, consistency, and function.